And counselors vying for the job will be filling 25 seats instead of 47, pitting some incumbent counselors against each other. Joining us now live, two of them, Paula Fletcher, representing Ward 30, Mary Fragedakis, currently representing Ward 29, but now campaigning for a spot in what's called Ward 14 now, pretty much the same area. Danforth, thanks for both of you joining us. I guess we're talking about this, you know, incumbent versus incumbent rivalry, yet, but the two of you, you get along great. Do you see a difference between the two of you at all on any of the issues? We'll start with you, Mary.
Policy-wise, I don't think we've actually really ever differentiated in, at least in the 8 years that I've been on council.
So voting identically on pretty much every issue?
Pretty close to voting identically.
So how?
So not happy about the smooshing together of these two wards and the overall 25 ward scenario that was forced on us by the province.
I mean, Tory did say a referendum after this election. Do you agree with that? Should they just let this go and move forward, or should they continue to pursue this to go back to 47?
I don't think it's going to be up to the mayor in terms of a referendum, because there's an appeal that's going to be heard at some point in November, and whatever the outcome of that is, I'm sure that there's going to possibly be an appeal of whatever that decision is. So I think this is hardly over. It just it's a little unclear what the future holds, except that we're having an election in 10 days.
That we know.
Do you want this
to go back to 47, or does it matter to let the courts decide?
You know, the courts are going to decide a lot of things now, and this appeal. This is pretty big, you know, when a provincial government just walks in and rips up 4 years of work on electoral reform. So City Council said, let's just take this as far as we can, because the relationship between the province of Ontario and the city of Toronto, the biggest one in Canada and sixth largest in North America, needs to be a bit more respectful. So I think through the courts, we may find something very interesting at the end of the day. But unfortunately, right now, we're having to run against one another.
Yeah.
And what do you say to voters who are trying to choose? I mean, which one should they choose?
Well, they say, obviously, Mary says, choose me. And I say, choose me.
But why?
But there's, you know, we're very respectful.
Yeah.
So this isn't a slugfest. Some of them up there, an incumbent versus incumbent, are pretty nasty.
Yeah.
So we have done a lot of work together over the years, and particularly after the Danforth shooting, the terrible tragedy.
Yeah.
And to be pitted against one another, our communities don't want us to fight, but they wanted us to tell them what we're doing, and they're very loyal to us.
No, Nathan, I mean, we're not running against each other. I consider it campaigning for the job.
That's really how I've decided
to look at it. I won't speak negatively about Paula. I certainly wouldn't speak negative about any of the candidates that are running, all 10 of us. I mean, I just try to focus on why I want to be the councillor. That's my decision, and it's up to the public at the end of the day to decide. We live in a democracy, sort of.
For sure.
And the people will decide on the 22nd.
Yeah, they will. So you did mention the Danforth shooting. As far as reducing crime, maybe a gun ban, what are some solutions you have to reducing gun violence?
Well, City Council did vote to ask the federal government for a gun ban, because they were the ones who would have to do that, and also for the province to ban the sale of ammunition. But we do have to get in early into communities and assist families, not just kids, but families, and to have kids go on a different path. But sometimes when they're very seasoned, that's a very difficult thing to do.
Yeah, you have to provide alternatives to young people so that they don't choose a life of crime. There's got to be other things for them to do, and there's groups in the East End and in East York when we had violence in 2006, and East York Strategy was started, where they looked for other things for kids to do that wasn't a life of crime, and it was a lot of after-school recreation programs, and the interfaith community became heavily involved in providing those options to young people in the East End to say, you know what, there are other things you could be doing, whether it's sports, whether it's arts, whether it's some other recreational form, help with homework. We know people work, and sometimes they work two or three jobs to make ends meet, and sometimes they're just not home, and so there have to be other things and other people looking out for the young people in our community.
It also has to be good education, and very happy that in what was Donmount, which is now Rivertown, it was the very first Toronto Community Housing Revitalization, and Pathways to Education, which has been in Regent Park, has now moved there after years of saying, please come over, because we have to give kids all the tools they need Sometimes in the education system, they face discrimination if they're coming from a poor community, and everybody has to have a great chance. So I'm very happy with Pathways, and we need to expand those types of mentoring and assistance to kids to get past high school, get into college or university.
All right, let's talk a bit about transit. The downtown relief line, I know that Keysmat says it should be done sooner, pretty much the same idea.
We're only waiting for $8 billion for that, Nathan. So my part that's south of the Danforth has been designed and planned now over a number of years, and shortly we will know the cost, the same as we'll know the cost for the Scarborough subway very shortly, and it's at 30% design. I also have the two stations for the smart track, assuming the province still proceeds with RER and having more trains. So next up will be the relief line going to Eglinton.
Yeah, so that's the discussion that we're having now that the city has undertaken is the routing of the relief line north that would go from Pape Station and up Pape, but where up Pape, when it goes up to Pape, when it hits O'Connor, does it go across the Leaside Bridge or does it go along O'Connor and head to the Woodbine Bridge? So that's a conversation that's underway right now, and encouraging people to go onto the city's website to look at some of that and have a think about how they think that should proceed, because that connection will be to the crosstown at Eglinton.
All right, let's talk about...
Very expensive, though, to cross the Don Valley for, just as we're finding up on the Eglinton crosstown. Getting over the river, big deal.
All right, let's talk a bit about the legalization of marijuana coming next week. Just for your own ward, if elected, what advice would you give the mayor as far as handling it in your ward?
Well, already, it's very disturbing that the announcement was made we're going to legalize marijuana, and then we had a system set out where it was going to be like the LCBO. Mm-hmm. And the location was picked out for the East End. It was going to be on Queen Street East. Mm-hmm. Everybody was very happy. And now we're back to kind of the corner store sale of marijuana. In East Chinatown, there are four stores, two across from each other. And the merchants are having a very hard time with that because people are standing outside, they're smoking outside. They have to close up early at night. The customers don't like it. So I think from the city's point of view, we have to be very strict. And Mary and I actually wrote a letter together a while ago that said, no, you can't have them beside one another. They have to be a certain distance from
school.
No ATM machines, no candy right next door. There was a whole number of things City Council did pass. And I think we'll go back with that and say we have to be quite strict about the siting of these shops.
So if they follow these restrictions, not an issue if it's in your ward, as long as they follow those rules.
Well, if they follow the rules and they're not like next to schools and that their people are not driving under the influence, I think is going to be a huge issue. I know that there have been a lot of issues with the legalization of marijuana in many states in the United States, and they've said that they've had a lot of issues with respect to testing and how do you test and how do you test appropriately and at the side of the road. And I think that's going to be something that we're going to have to deal with in this city. I realize that, the police are quite taxed in trying to be everything to everybody, but this is going to add a new dimension to their responsibilities.
All right, Mary Fragedakis, Paula Fletcher, that's it for our time. Thank you so much. Of course, the election next week, Monday.
Thanks for coming in. Monday, 22nd.
Absolutely.